Praise God. Good afternoon,
come on,
everybody.
Y'all do better than that.
Come on, good afternoon.
This is Resurrection Sunday. Come on.
Come on, y'all. Where the people of God? No, no, I want a little better than that. Come on, y'all give me like a
come
half.
Come on and stand to your feet. He's alive. Hallelujah.
Come on, y'all.
We give you glory this afternoon.
That's all right, babe. People are used to morning hours, so, you know, right. We're afternoon kind of church, so it's all right. It is all right. So we just want to, today we're going to do a little something different. Again, it's not your typical service, right? And we purposely made you stand because you're going to sit down anyway, right? So anyway, it's going to be a different kind of service because we have like an illustrated sermon that's about to go down. You know, you've seen the flyers, the Atonement, right? Today's the days of the Atonement. I'm looking forward to it. I know you're going to be blessed by it. So I want to just greet everybody. Any new timers in the house? First time walking through the door. Raise your hand.
We welcome you. Puerto Rico,
we
then
met
Jersey.
Him, and now he's here in Jersey, so you know God is good. Praise God. I didn't want to come back from Puerto Rico.
But anyway. Me either.
Anyway, I'm going to start a church there, right?
What?
Anyway, so I'm glad you made it.
Yes.
I'm glad you made it here.
Yes.
And if it's your first time or your 100th time, you are now family.
Yes.
We love you. I don't care.
Yes.
What? You come home, right? This is your home. This is your house. We're family always. Praise God. So, Pastor Dai, why don't you just give us our quick announcements because we got stuff to do.
So, like we said, we're going to do things a little bit different today. We're just going to, we'll pray, and then we'll go through our announcements, and then we have a special service for each and every one of you today. So,
don't forget about the, you know, tithes and offerings.
Oh, no, I'm not going to forget about the tithes
sure.
and offerings.
Sure.
First things first.
That keeps it
No, seriously, first things first, we want to give glory and honor to God. We thank you. Let's just open up in prayer. Father, we thank you, oh God. We thank you for what you're doing here in the Bronx, what you're doing in each and every one of our lives, oh God. We know that we did not come here. We have an agenda. We have a skit, oh God, but you have your way in this house. So we lift up your name. We give you glory. We give you honor in Jesus' name. So if you don't know, you are at the 3:30 service. We usually 30. And then on Tuesdays, we have our men's and women's group at 7 o'clock. And then at 8 o'clock, have our Lots Ministry as well, which is the heart of PLCC. It's Love on the Streets. They meet every first and third Saturday of the month. And we have a young adults group that meets every first and third Saturday, every first and third Friday of the month. And so if you don't follow us, you can follow us on Facebook, or you can go on our website, which is www.PLCCBronx.org. We all have a new website, so we're excited about that too. With our ministry on there, if you want to share, if you'd like to give and partner with us.
Be good.
They really do. Our family looks like a little Easter basket.
It is.
Okay.
My son and his
sister.
And my daughter-in-law.
And this was not planned. And then I saw Deborah. I said, Deborah, I need a picture with you in our group. Because you just fit right on in.
It's like that whole lavender look and all that. Looking real cute. Pastor Dot, please get pray. Get pray for the offering.
Father, we thank you for what you're doing in this house.
God.
We lift up this. Oh God, that you would give us wisdom and that you would give us to minister here in this community. Honor in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen.
Seat, right? You got envelopes in, you know, for those, right? Check your seat. You have an envelope, right? So our ushers are available, right? So ushers, do your job. Hit it. Praise God.
Guys, we also ask that if you could just listen to our ushers. If anybody has to use the restroom, if you would just raise your hand, one of our ushers. There are going to be ushers on every single aisle. If you could get there, two in the front, two in the back, all across, and then also all across the back. And if you have to use the restroom or anything, just raise your hand and they'll escort you. We want to continue to practice social distancing and be safe.
Rock. Let them just rock out. If they slain or something, let them fall.
The floor's too.
Oh my. If you want to stand, you stand. If you want to sit, or you want to kneel, whatever you got to do, it's a place of, it's a house of worship. You worship how you like.
Amen.
It's a free place, so do what you want, right? Praise God. Praise God. Just want to make sure the ushers are done because I don't want to go ahead, right? So it'll start, right? Somebody give me the thumbs up when you're done. We good?
Thumbs up.
You good?
All right, let's get this party started.
PLCC presents The Atonement.
Yes.
All right.
Worship team.
Come on, guys.
Sanctuary, pure and Promised Land. Wait, what kind of church is this again? Community church? It's all the same. It's all religion. Did you enjoy that opening?
Yeah.
Did you really? I guess if you're into that kind of music, you know, I don't know. It sounded like they got like maybe 3 rehearsals in. I don't know. Maybe it's just me. But you know, I'm sorry. Where are my manners? I have not even introduced myself. Who I am is, it's complicated. See, we go by so many different names. I've been called an accuser, and I've been called a persecutor or a prosecutor? Actually, I've been called both. And recently on a Zoom call, I was even called Pedro. That's not relevant, but I just wanted to share that. But for this evening's purposes, you can just call me your judge. You know, I heard that. And you must be thinking, judge? Only God could judge me. You know, and I've been watching you, how this group moves, you know, and it seems like no matter what we try, you guys just keep meeting. You know, you guys get displaced. I mean, what is this, your 5th place? I've lost count, you know, and you guys keep meeting. You get a pandemic, and then you get cute and start live streaming, and you guys keep meeting. Even a fire can't stop you guys from meeting. And you don't know how frustrating that is. I mean, you guys are like, oh, stay on that wall. We got to stay on that wall. You put sconces on the wall. And no matter what happens, you just keep meeting. So if I had to compare, what is something that you want to get rid of, but no matter how hard you try, you can't? If I had to compare you guys to, I compare you to roaches. No matter how hard you try, you think you get rid of them, but oh, you open up the cupboard and there comes another one. And you guys are like not just any normal roaches, you guys are reformed roaches, you know? Not the little R, the big R. I get it, you know? But let me stay focused, because I came here for a purpose. See, if I had my way, you guys are laughing and enjoying all this. You wear this as a badge of honor, all these accomplishments, right? You guys are H2K, hard to kill, right? And you wear that as an honor. You look at that as an honor. But what I see today, I see murderers. Liars. I see hypocrites. And if I had my way, I would sentence you all to death. Because, but since I can't get you all, even though I've tried, I'm going to start with just one. Today, one of your very own is going to be sentenced to death. You could bring her in.
Hold
to me. I am weak without you. I can't breathe without you. But I can make it through if you hold on to me. When my life is broken and still your arms are open, your love can make me new. You are my everything. I run into your name, Jesus. He won't let go of me. Christ, my Savior, He's faithful. God is
You are being sentenced to death for murder.
Murder? I never killed anyone. I don't even know how I got here.
Doesn't the law say that anyone who is angry or harbors malice towards their brother is guilty?
Brother? I don't even have a brother. I only got sisters. You can ask my mom. She's right there.
That's cute. Shout out to mommy. Real cute. You think this is a joke? You think I'm playing games?
I think you're crazy.
The law goes on to say that anyone who even calls someone a fool is in danger of a fiery hell.
Words? You're trying to sentence me to death for words? This is ridiculous. They're just words.
Are they just words? Or are they weapons of mass destruction? Let me ask you this. How many family members have you torn down with just words? How many relationships have been destroyed by just words? How many members of this congregation have you assassinated with your words and your posts? And speaking of posts, you are being sentenced to death for idolatry.
Idolatry? What have I ever put before God? But this is not funny anymore.
Maybe you should ask, what haven't you put before God? How much time do you spend being a Facebook philosopher? And it seems like when I just scroll through your posts, you prefer to just put your own political agenda over God's agenda. Isn't that all idolatry?
What? You trying to sentence me to death for what I'm sharing on social media? This is ridiculous. Everybody shares. Everybody accountable for this.
You see, I don't make the laws. I only interpret them. And there's a saying that the devil is in the details. Quick, you guys like doing this. Somebody quote that on Facebook. You guys like to post in the middle of services. Put that quote out there. The devil is in the details. And this devil, I've seen your dirty details. Which is why I sentenced you to death for adultery.
Adultery? This man is sentencing me to death for adultery? I never slept with anyone's husband. Maybe a boyfriend or two, but not a husband. Look, this is ridiculous. It stopped being funny a long time ago. You need to get me out these chains.
Doesn't the law say that anyone who even looks at someone with lust in their heart is guilty of adultery?
You're trying to sentence me to death for looking? Oh, this is ridiculous.
You know what? Let's just cut to the chase. Because you've done a lot more than just looking in your lifetime. Oh, I've seen that resume. It's long. A long list of broken hearts and baby daddies.
I'm sorry? You just brought my kids into this? Oh, what? And you glad I'm in these handcuffs right
because
now?
Because
if I was
what
in
would
these
you
handcuffs
do?
Right
You're gonna
now.
What? Hit me? You wanna strike me? You know what's so ironic about that? Is that you're the one that's told to turn the other cheek. What you thought? You thought that you could come up here, sing a couple of songs, say a few amens, and your past is gonna escape you? That's never gonna go away. See, you're always gonna be that teenage pregnancy. You're always gonna be nothing more than a statistic.
Now you're judging my heart? You don't even know me. If you're judging my heart, then I don't stand a chance.
Finally, what I came here for, a broken spirit.
I love you, Lord.
Though your mercy never fails me, all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing in the goodness of God. All my life you have been so, so good. And every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing in the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been
What are you waiting for? Just get it over with. Done with it.
See, the heart is deceitful above all things. And from within your heart comes murder, idolatry, adultery. And for these things, you are being put to death. We can now begin the execution. This is the good part. Wait. What are you doing here? What are you doing? Clear. She deserves death. I prove that.
Who is this guy? Are you my lawyer? Are you here to get me out?
Look, there's nothing redeemable here. Nothing redeemable.
I never did any of this. Help me, please. Please.
See, she doesn't even recognize you. She doesn't even want you.
Want you? Why would I even want you?
Elaine. Why are you crying?
Jesus, you know me? Why are you here? Are you here to judge me too?
Yes, that's right. That's right.
You know, I wasn't always like this. You know everything that I've been through.
He knows. He didn't do nothing.
As a matter of fact, where were you then? Where were you when I was calling out for help, when I was crying and praying?
You see.
Now you show up.
She doesn't even understand you're the only reason.
Yourself?
No! Stay in that chair. Stay in that chair.
Wait, you're...
No!
You're letting me out? I guess this is why they say that grace is amazing, because it is. I could just leave? Wow. Wait. You really came through for me. Thank you.
You gotta get back in that chair.
No, but he just said that
somebody has to pay the price today.
But he said I could leave.
The law is the law.
Wait, what are you doing? What are you doing? No, please. Wait.
When it seems there's nothing left. Lord, I need you to step in. Give me a second wind. Lord, with your help, I know that I will win. When it hurts, I know you're moving what's ahead. You have for me.
Now, I need you to get up from this chair. Please, please, just get up. Get him out this chair, please. Look, this man means it. He's gonna kill you. Please, get up. Please.
You are being sentenced to death.
No, no.
For Elaine Rodriguez.
Wait, wait, no, no. No, it's me. I should be in the chair. It's my sin. I did this. You gotta get him out, please. Get him out the chair. Please, you can't do this, not for me. Not after all I've done. It was my heart that was full of sin. It was my place, but you took it.
For holding on to faith you know that. Cause nothing can catch you by surprise. You've got this figured out and you're watching us now. But when it looks as if we can win, you wrapped us in your arms and stayed. And everything we need you supply. And it looked as if it was over. You made a
because you may, and we're standing here only because.
Who can testify?
And we're standing here only because you may.
Come on, raise your hands and say, come on.
And we're standing here only because you may. Cause you move mountains. You cause walls to fall, yeah, with your power. You perform miracles, and there is nothing,
and that's impossible. And we're standing here only because you made.
Report, would you believe the prophet Isaiah? Y'all can have a seat. I just need 10 minutes of your time, I promise. He said, whose report would you believe? It's found in the book of Isaiah. If you don't have a Bible, there's a little Bible app that you can look up. For all you newcomers, if you go to the app, please, it says Holy Bible. It's brown. Really quick, I'll give you 2 minutes to grab it. And it's free. Oh, come on, y'all be downloading some other stuff. Come on. So there was a prophet by the name of Isaiah. And Isaiah, in the book of Isaiah, where I'm going to share with you, I'm just going to be a it means that there would, that a divine one would be born, has been born, or would have been born to save the world. The suffers because of the sins of others. Guess what, guys? We're the others. Over 2,000 years later, Jesus came and fulfilled this prophecy through his death on the cross, and that is why we are here today. If you just go, I know y'all got that little Bible app, go to Isaiah 53. I'm just going to go through it really quickly with you all. In the chapter, I'll just do one through, it's chapter. That was here, that was judging Elaine. Would you believe the report of the enemy? Would you believe the report of your past? In verse 2, it says, he grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He wasn't even handsome. If we saw him in the street, is not a friends rejected by those who were supposed to stick it out with us. Let me continue. Come on, that word rejected just threw me all off and stuff. Oh, rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one from whom people hide their faces. He has been despised, and we held him in our lives. We know what that feels like. I know that we've all come in here with some. He has come to take every burden, every pain. When Jesus is walking with the disciples, he says to them in Luke 12, he says to the disciples, he took the 12 aside and he said to them, look, we are going into Jerusalem right before his crucifixion, and says everything that the prophets have written about the Son of Man will be fulfilled. And today, even today as we stand here, he is still fulfilling the promises for us. Amen. And verse 4, it says, but surely he took on our pain. Come on and say, surely, surely he took, not maybe, perhaps, what if. It says, surely he took on our pain. He didn't only rob the grave, he took it. He took it, and today we celebrate that. He took on my sadness. He took on my infirmities. He took on my addiction. He took on my problems. He took on that. Considered him punished, God stricken, and stricken by him and a. Every time we worry about provision, he's the provider. Come on, I know a lot of us have lost our jobs in this pandemic, and he has provided. I know a lot of us thought we were going to lose our mind, and he's kept us. We didn't know what we were going to do with these kids. The school system, how was I going to be a working parent? How was I going to do it? And he's kept me. We're standing here because he made a way. A year ago, we didn't know what this was going to look like. COVID. Some of us have survived the impossible. We're still here. Amen. Then we go into verse 5. It says, but he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. You know what iniquities are? It's our grossness. It's our wickedness. He took that on. It says it right here. I didn't say it. It says it here. I promise. I promise it says it here. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. This is one of my favorite verses. I love to when someone comes and they're saying, Pastor Dye, can you pray for me? I'm not feeling good. Pastor Dye, I got the report of the Lord. I go, well, let me tell you what his word said. His word tells me here, it says, by his stripes we are healed. It says wounds here, but there's different trends. When you see the little Bible app, wounds. And some of these wounds are in physical. Some of them are in the natural. Some of them aren't always a sickness. It's stuff that's been put on us by abandonment. We've been abandoned. We've been broken. Some of us as children have gone through some things that are unexplainable. Our mothers didn't defend us when they were supposed to stand in the gap. But he stood in the gap. He stands in the gap for you. And then I'm going to go all the way, if you go into the Message translation of the Bible, I took this part out of the translation because it was just so, it just seemed more clear to me. And then the Message, it says, he was beaten, he was tortured, but he didn't say a word. Like a sheep being how many times and they're saying this is what I'm let me give you what my philosophy I'm shame the devil text off the ledge. Don't do it. Be quiet. Sometimes we gotta be quiet. He's already paid the price for us. Sometimes we got to be still and know that he is God all by himself. He comes. He said, it says, the Lord is my banner. He goes before me. Before I even go in a room, he's there before me. Before I even go in the courtroom, before anything, he goes before me because he lives within me. Come on, that wasn't in my notes, but okay. See, when I go off, then I'll be like, oh, gosh. All this studying. Come on. All right. And it says, he took it all on in silence. Justice was miscarried, and he was let off. And did anyone really know what was happening? He died without a thought for even his own welfare. Beaten bloody for the sins of my people. They buried him with the wicked, threw him in the grave with a rich man, even though he had not even hurt a But he did it for you, and he did it for me. He did it for my past. He did it for my present. He did it for the future. Amen. Verse of the Bible, it shows that even in his death, he took transgressions. And today we celebrate his death. On Friday, they nailed him to the cross. On Saturday, we mourned. And on Sunday, when they went to go grieve at the grave, it was empty. It was empty because he rose, just like his word said. He rose again. Amen. And church, we have given you a description. We've given you a live description of what's happened. Is that it's not too late. Some of us think it's too late. I'm in my 40s. I'm in my 50s. It's never too late. It is never too late for him to do a new thing in your life. It is never too late to do a new thing in your home. It is never too late to believe God for a miracle in your life. He is able. So I'm asking you now, if this is your first time here, Ellie, I'm going to ask you to play some music to massage the hearts. If this is your first time here, first I'm going to ask our pastors if they would just stand, and our ministry leaders if they would just stand. And if you would just go around and scatter yourselves around the sanctuary as a sign of community. We want to pray for you. We can't pray for you and have an altar call, but we can extend our hands and we can nail our faith to the cross with you and believe with you. If this is your first time here and you're tired of hurting and you're broken, and even throughout the entire message, throughout our skit, you felt a tug, but you weren't sad because it was a beautiful thing to see. And I would invite you to and tell you that is the Lord tugging at your heart. He came to meet you here today. It's not an accident. It's not by mistake.
He's come to meet you. And if you don't know what that commitment is going to look like, it's okay. It's by faith. It's by faith that you say, you know what? I'm tired. I don't know how to do it on my own anymore. Every time I do it, I screw it up. Even if you just wake up tomorrow morning and say, I don't know what happened at that church, the covenant, the crop, whatever they called it. By the way, we are the Promised Land Covenant Church, just to correct that judge. And yes, this is our fifth place, but we're still standing. And no fire and no hell is going to get in the way of what God is going to do through us for his people. Because I don't know about you, but I've got some promises that I still haven't seen, and I'm waiting for them. And I'm going to stand, and I'm going to believe until I see them come to pass. They were given to me. Let me tell you something. 20 years ago, I walked into a church with a little boy. He was about 8 or 9 years old. And I remember walking into that church. And I remember they had a whole big fancy thing just like this. And I knew about the church. I grew up in the church, and I knew better. I know that I came in there limping, and I come up the only one that's thrown a blow in her day when they've come for us. And I remember walking into that. I remember being in that room, and it's kind of similar to where we are here. The floor was just as hard and concrete as this one, so don't fall out. And I remember the pastor. Well, first, I always thought to myself, I said, you know, when I hear the voice of God, right, we think we hear the voice of God as thunder and lightning and rah. No, it was just the pastor that day speaking some truth into my life, like what's happening here. And I remember the pastor saying to me, when God has a message, it just feels so direct into you. And I remember him saying, I promise you, if you surrender your life to me, I will never let another man lay his hands on you or your child. And I remember responding. I remember saying, first of all, how do you know my business? That's number one, what I said. But I do remember responding to that altar call, probably not even understanding what was happening. And here I am 20 years later, serving the Lord with my husband, who's a pastor today with me, and my son sitting in the front seat, still believing for God's promises for our lives. It doesn't all get better by tomorrow. But let me tell you, I'd much rather be one day in his house than 1,000 elsewhere. I'd much rather drag my family into the church than not come in at all. I'd much rather say, you know what, I'll just be a hypocrite and find out later if this thing was being a hypocrite or not, than to find out later that it wasn't. And I cannot tell you how much it brings. There are so many miracles that I've seen, so many signs and wonders. So if you would commit with me today, if this is your first time and you're tired and you find yourself in a situation, if you would just raise your hand, there are ushers around you that will pray for you. Maybe you don't want to be seen. Maybe you can just go like this a little bit. Or maybe you want to take a step in boldness and stand and say, I'm done. I'm going to walk into this thing, this relationship, because that's what it's about. It's not about religion. It's not about how good we are. It's about a relationship with someone that fell in love with us, that thought we were to die for. And if you are here, you've been to church, and you want to recommit yourself, the pandemic has thrown some things off for us. You haven't really been inside of a church because we haven't been able to. And you kind of wandered off of that Zoom thing, and you just couldn't do it, and you didn't want to see the faces. Bah, bah. We know the church hurt me. Yeah. No. And if you find yourself there and you want to recommit yourself, would you stand? Would you raise your hand? We'll stand with you. We'll stand with you. We'll do community together. We're not always going to get it right, but we promise to stand with you. for us, the believers, you know, let us never forget that it's by his grace that we're here, that he keeps us, not because we responded and it was perfect and we had got it all together and look at me, not because of that. It is because of the thorn in our flesh that keeps us. I am so grateful that I still struggle with many things today, because those things are what keeps me on my knees. Those things are what keep me humble and remembering it's by his grace. Paul says in Corinthians 12, y'all with the new Bible app, y'all write this down. Y'all go back and look at it. Paul says in 2 Corinthians, I'm reading from the message. Because of the extravagance of those revelations, and so I wouldn't get big-headed, I was given a gift of a handicap to keep me in consistent touch with my limitations. That means he was given a thorn in his flesh. We don't know what that is. Whether it be he not know his identity, whether it be, I don't know, whatever he was struggling with. I don't know what they could have possibly struggled with back then. I mean, they were walking with Jesus. I mean, they knew him firsthand. But it says, I was given a handicap in consistent touch with my limitation. Satan's angels did his best. Who we are and who we aren't. He did his best to get me down. What in fact he did was push me to my knees. No danger of walking around high and mighty. At first, I didn't think of it as a gift, and I begged God to remove it. 3 times I did that. And then he told me, my grace is enough. It's all you need. My strength comes into its own in your weakness.